Today, we will talk about this double-line reactor. The double-line reactor is used for current purification. Current purification is done to improve the power factor and make it as perfect as possible. At this point, many of you might be wondering, if this is a single reactor, why am I calling it a double-line reactor? Now, you might be curious about the difference between the first reactor and the second one. I'll explain that as well. Both of these components are used to correct the power factor, and they operate in the same way. However, despite their similar function, there is a significant difference between the two. I will explain this difference here. So, first of all, we need to look at it from a technical perspective to understand what it actually is. I will explain its mechanism to you through a diagram. If we look closely, this reactor is divided into two parts, one coil on one side and another coil on the other side. First, I will draw these coils for you. Besides these, there are also additional coils present in this reactor, and I will show them to you as well. So as you can see, the first coil inside is wound in a circular manner using thick wire. This is done to ensure a smooth flow of current. On both sides, the same type of wire is wound in a similar way, forming this setup. In addition to this, on the other side, we can also see some wires. These wires have their own specific purpose and working mechanism. I will explain how they function on the PCB. Let's get back to its diagram. As you can see, the coils are placed separately and are not connected to each other. The lower wires are thick, while the upper wires are thin. Now, if we talk about this single-line reactor, it contains a single coil that is wound in a circular manner. One side serves as the input, and the other side acts as the output. This is how it operates. Now, I will explain how to test it. There are 8 points to check, and we will test them step by step. First, we will check the points with the thick wires. These wires should have a small amount of resistance. As you can see, it shows a resistance of 0.2 ohms. Similarly, if we check the next point, it also has resistance in the same range. There should be no short circuit between these wires, and additionally, there should be no short circuit between these wires and the other wires. In other words, these are 4 separate coils, each working independently. Now, the testing of these other wires will be done as follows. You should observe a small resistance here, but the value should not be too high. If the resistance increases significantly, it indicates that the reactor is faulty. Additionally, if any of these wires disconnects, the reactor will not work properly and it will need to be repaired. This is how you can test it. Let's discuss further. The single line reactor is an 8 ampere reactor. When we look at the double line reactor, it's much smaller in size, but it is a 20 ampere reactor. Additionally, I have another reactor that is about 14 amperes, and although it's not as small as the double line reactor, it is much larger in size and mass. If we look at it further, the core of this reactor is made of metal, which is laminated with thin iron sheets. On the other hand, in the case of the double line reactor, a ferrite core is used. The ferrite core is placed at the top and bottom of the reactor, and the coils are passed through the center of the ferrite core. Now let's talk about how these reactors are installed on the PCB and how the two reactors work. Here you can see that a double line reactor is installed, and on this PCB, 2 diodes and 2 IGBTs are also used. This setup helps improve the power factor correction, PFC, by ensuring that the current flow is as smooth as possible. The smoother the current, the less the chances of damage. This also protects the IPM, intelligent power module, from damage, ensuring that the compressor remains safe and unaffected. To better understand this, I will create a diagram and explain how it works. Now I've created the diagram. As you can see, the reactor is placed at the top, and the 2 IGBTs are at the bottom. Here, this point and this point are connected in series, and a positive line is present. The DC electric current is coming to this point. Now, in the IGBT, the negative points are present on both emitters. This point is connected to the collector, and the second point is also attached to the collector. Additionally, diodes are placed along with these, whose cathode pins are connected on one common point. These diodes are called flywheel or snubber diodes. These are used to protect positive voltages from moving back to the reactors. These diodes are directing current towards the IPM. The entire system is functioning in this manner. These gates are used to turn the IGBTs on or off, which allows power correction to happen at 2 different points. This setup ensures that the load is distributed across both IGBTs. In this PCB, the reactor and the IGBT on the right are called the master converter, and on the left side are known as the slave converter. Each IGBT handles a smaller load, which reduces the chances of them overheating. Here, since there are 2 reactors, the load is also distributed, which further reduces the overall load on each component. This helps the system work more efficiently and at a faster speed. In this way, the entire system operates smoothly. Commonly, The circuits of inverter mini-split air conditioners are designed such that their PWM frequency ranges from 20 kHz to 45 kHz, and a value between these is set. When PWM signals are applied to these, the master and slave IGBTs will have a difference in their on and off timing. For example, if this system is operating at a frequency of 20 kHz, then when the master IGBT is on, the slave will be off. After that, the slave will turn on, and the master will turn off. Subsequently, the slave will turn off, and the master will turn on. This on-off cycle will continue in this manner, with the difference in their on-off timings being in nanoseconds. When this signal turns on, and this will be the moment when the reactor gets charged. Let me also explain how it charges. When the gate of the IGBT is turned on, the emitter is at a lower potential, typically ground or negative voltage, and the collector is at a higher positive voltage. When the gate is triggered with the appropriate voltage exceeding the threshold, the IGBT allows current to flow from the collector to the emitter. This current flow causes the master reactor to charge, storing energy as a magnetic field, while the slave reactor will remain in the off position. As soon as the master reactor charges, the master IGBT will turn off, and the charge current will flow towards the diode, which will direct it to the IPM. A few nanoseconds later, the slave IGBT will turn on, causing the slave reactor to charge. It will then discharge, and the cycle will continue. Now, let's talk about the advantages and disadvantages. If we look at the single-line reactor, it works perfectly in the PCB it is designed for. This is because the PCB is manufactured according to the specifications of this reactor, ensuring that it does not cause any damage. So far, I have not observed any disadvantages of this setup. In addition, if we look at the double-line reactor, it is smaller in size and offers several advantages. By using two IGBTs, the system operates at high speed, allowing for better and more precise power factor correction. This setup is also a perfect system, and so far, no significant disadvantages have been observed. Let's discuss why these four wires are installed in the double-line reactor. I'll explain it to you. Now, let's understand this reactor from the low-side perspective. The side with thinner wires represents the low-side connections. One pin of the reactor is connected to the PCB through the trace I have pointed out. The other pin, which belongs to the auxiliary winding, is also connected to this specific trace on the PCB. When I trace both of these connections on the PCB, I find that they loop around the board and converge at this particular point. Now, I will flip this circuit board to its other side. So one trace is arriving at this point, and the other trace is coming to this point. Let me also show you which pins of the reactor are connected to these points. Let's trace where the master auxiliary winding of this reactor is going. I'll flip the board again, positioning the reactor side to my left. Then, I'll use a multimeter to check the connections on the left side. I'll set the multimeter to continuity mode and first verify that the multimeter is working correctly. The multimeter's beep mode is working perfectly. So, I place one probe on the point connected to the master auxiliary winding. Then I'll check it against various points here to determine the connection. There is no beep sound when checking with this point. Now I will place the red probe on another point. At this point, the auxiliary winding is making a connection. Here, two resistors are connected, R117 and R116. The resistor R117 has a value of 8.1 kiloohms, and the resistor R116 also has the same resistance value of 8.1 kiloohms. These traces loop around and are connected to this IC. Let me also confirm this for you using the multimeter. Let's check pin number 1 of this IC. Here, we get a beep sound, confirming the connection. The resistor labeled 47 is connected to the auxiliary winding, which belongs to the slave reactor. The trace of this resistor loops around and connects to pin number 2 of the IC. This IC continuously monitors both overcurrent and undercurrent conditions through these two points. Additionally, it performs other functions, such as controlling the on and off states of the IGBTs. This IC also communicates with the microcontroller, receiving commands from it, and in some cases, sending commands back. Whenever an overcurrent or undercurrent situation arises, the IC sends a command to the microcontroller, which then takes action to shut down the entire board for protection. As we know, no circuit can operate without both a positive and a negative connection. Since there are coils here, having just one connection wouldn't allow it to function. That's why we'll now discuss the second point as well. The first points are connected to the IC for current detection. Now, how is the EMF generated here? For that, a negative point is also necessary. let me show you where the negative point or ground comes from. It originates from the negative terminals of these capacitors and connects to the negative side of the coils. This connection also extends to the MCU simultaneously. Through this setup, EMF is generated, which is discharged as current towards the IC. This is how the whole system functions. I hope today's video has been highly informative for you and that you have gained valuable insights from it. Click on the left or right thumbnail to watch our next videos and subscribe. Thank you.